We've talked multiple times about how everyone's got the attention span of a gnat. We're constantly foaming at the mouth for more dopamine hits, and it's honestly ridiculous how hard it is for our brains to sit down with more than one thing without being distracted by the next thing. Who has the brain capacity for this? 30 songs? There's no way I'm getting through this whole thing in one sitting. And who has ever planned multiple time slots to sit through the same album? The music labels have to, again, latch onto another gimmick to suck as many streams as possible out of the listeners. Nobody is going to listen to all that! Albums haven't ever been confined to a set number of songs in the past, but there has always been a bit of psychology that plays into creating a concise and replayable listen for a lot of commercially recognizable albums. But in today's era of digital streams being the powerhouse of the music industry, labels are constantly experimenting with different ways to squeeze as many streams out of the artist as possible. It started very healthy. An artist would put out an album and let it soak for a while so the fans could fully absorb the message it was trying to portray. Then a few months later, you might be pleasantly surprised with two or three deluxe tracks that you'd find waiting patiently after the outro track. In high school, when I first started getting deep into music around 2016, I was into the SoundCloud era that had cemented itself as a sign of the times back then. You know, way back in the olden days when we put Jolly Ranchers in our purple Fanta and we thought we were the truth. Love Is Rage 2's deluxe came out around that time and opened my third eye thanks to life-changing lyrics like these. I appreciated this way of dropping additional content into an already polished record. After the album ages enough to leave the listeners hungry for more, the personality and aesthetic oozing from a specific record gets a facelift to keep it from aging so quickly. But a few years passed and the landscape begins to try and adapt to the new habitat artists are residing in. It became more common to see newer albums with over an hour of runtime with 20 plus songs on release day. And I noticed this a lot in the trap rap genre with artists like Trippie Redd, who would drop full-length albums once or twice a year with a runtime of over an hour each. And I have my own personal thoughts on how long an album should be to maximize your attention and returnability to a certain project, as long as it needs to get your point across. I mean, seriously, there's no limit or format an album needs to be in to have your project resonate with people. Now, there are preferences to the rule if you're listening to an artist you don't frequent, and for me, that typically sits around 40 to 45 minutes. I've noticed that when I want to relive an experience an album put me on, for a car ride or if I'm just in the mood for it, that typically tends to be a sweet spot where I have no urge to cut the album prematurely and move on to something else. But it's nice to even get a bite-sized portion with the flavor of a three-course meal packed into it. Albums like Aries' 2019 Welcome Home album had a runtime of 24 minutes with 9 songs, but every one of those songs made my playlist, and several of them are still in my rotation to this day. Everyone's familiar with Kids See Ghosts for being notoriously short with 7 songs and a runtime of 23 minutes. And it performed exceptionally well critically, as well as Pusha T's Daytona 7-track record running a short but sweet 21-minute runtime. Denzel Curry and Kenny Beats Unlocked, Earl Sweatshirt some rap songs, Good Faith by Madian, very fulfilling listens that won't eat up too much of your time. But I want to switch it up from my personal opinion and give another one of my personal opinions on a different question I've been asking myself. Does the length of an album affect its shelf life? When I mention album runtimes having a sweet spot, I typically focus on how that will contribute to the album's lifespan for holding onto the highest return rate of first-time listeners to rotation listeners. An album that has very few skips throughout the entire tracklist is more likely to have diminishing returns the more songs that are on it. When the album length hits a certain threshold, the concept of that album might start to be lost along the way, and can leave a heavier impact on the record if the song is out of place or unnecessary, even if the first half of the album was strong sonically. This goes for albums of all shapes and sizes. I look back at Gorilla's album Cracker Island from last year. I enjoyed this record overall, but I haven't listened to the album through as much since its release. A lot of the first half of that album were singles leading up to its release, so as those songs would periodically come and go from my rotation, I developed a relationship with those songs more as an independent experience, as opposed to being a piece to a bigger puzzle that the record Cracker Island was possibly trying to be. Once I got to the latter half of the record, I wasn't connecting with it as much as I thought I would. I still recommend checking it out. It's not Damon's most out-of-the-box work, but it has some very enjoyable tracks like these. But back to how the runtime affects the shelf life of an album. I mentioned Trippie Redd previously, and how he is one of the most consistent artists dropping a project almost every year. Sometimes he'll even drop an album and a mixtape in the same year, possibly even dropping a deluxe alongside them. I hate to bring a cliche into the mix, and this is the most surface level it gets, but this is a case where quality over quantity reigns supreme. Because look at the reception of these albums. No hate towards Trippie Redd at all. I respect a few of his songs, but it is clear as day that the frequency that he puts projects together is hurting the reception of it. Now, he may just like to release music consistently and feed his fans, and that's what fulfills him as a creative, and that is perfectly fine. A lot of signed musicians would envy that sort of thing, because labels typically want you to hold on to that song as long as possible to maximize the hype surrounding the project. But if you take a closer look at the numbers streaming across the last few years of his album cycles, you'll start to notice a trend that these albums being released so close in proximity with 20 plus songs and extra content are hard to digest. This is hurting his future endeavors. Every time a long-form project comes with low fan reception, people will not have the desire to return to the project. Even future projects for that matter. If a discography over time starts to leave you feeling more of the same after every record, you'll lose interest in keeping up with their work. If they aren't providing the value you would hope or expect from some of their best work, you'll start to become more disinterested in what they have in store next. If this is your career, we need to focus on the long term. What is the best way to go about this? If I could, I'd like to share my personal thoughts on my preferred way to go about this. Plenty of artists that I have been listening to for years now and have succeeded in keeping my attention fall within most of my favorite attributes about an artist's discography. It needs to flow beautifully. We need to be able to clearly see a progression coming from the artist. Are you evolving with every record? Are you growing musically, lyrically? Can we tell you've been through more life experiences since your last project that are worth being told? This doesn't mean you need to sound drastically different on each project, but make just as fulfilling music as the last. It doesn't mean you should do more of the same that people have come to remember you for. This has no specific blueprint or plan to follow. This should come naturally. If you care about the art you're making, and the way you want it to be perceived, you will take a step with intention and attention. You'll see a lot of artists that are heavily influenced by their idols. Their first music will sound like they clearly had references they were pulling from, but through years of developing your own sound and personal experiences you need to tell, you will build your music into something more personal to you than it being a reflection or tribute of the music that has inspired you. And when that time comes to bring those ideas into reality, you need to have a clear goal in mind when telling a story. When you have that in mind, you want to tell that story in no more and no less time than it needs to be. So yeah, there's no runtime that's better than another. Tell the story the way it needs to be told. If there is filler that adds nothing or a track that contradicts an idea that aided the story, reconsider if that track adds anything to the experience. Forget capitalizing on streams and numbers, because if it isn't memorable, people will listen to it maybe once and then never again. You can release as much music as you want, just be aware of the effect it has because of the environment we are in right now. There is too much going on at once. If you leave a project that feeds into that one-and-done culture social media has built, then you will be just that to a playlist, to a listener, to a fan. If you release something that leaves a mark and makes a statement, it will stick around and do better than any double album, deluxe edition, Yo Mama's version could ever do.